Okay. Amen. We thank everyone for sharing in our tribal hymns and songs of praise, and for the flute. It is a message that we express from God through us, that all of God's creation can enjoy in it. We are thankful that we can share in that expression of the God that's in us, the salt that's in us. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful, O God, that you are God and God alone, worthy to be praised in the songs of Zion, O God, of which you have so given us. We are so thankful and grateful. We are thankful, O God, for this congregation, this assembling of ourselves, where you said that when we assemble ourselves as your children, you will be in our midst. You're certainly in our midst, and we are thankful and grateful that you brought us to this hour. And we ask now, O God, that you would hide me behind your dear cross, that we all will be able to hear what you desire for all of us to hear, in spite of what I may do or say. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. We want to combine some thoughts here today for today's lesson. Tomorrow is Indigenous Peoples Day. That's a holiday for us. Amen. Amen. And also on Tuesday, it's the last day for a person to register to vote in the state of Texas for this year. So we want to encourage the message that we hear today, encourage you to take that in consideration of what our obligations are and how we should express ourselves on tomorrow, as well as having that deadline of being registered to vote on tomorrow by Tuesday. A while back, we received a grant this church, and we had formed what we call the Indigenous Democracy is Indigenous, the DFW Coalition. We had a few weeks ago a major candidate to come and visit with us. We are an apolitical group that seeks to engage our community in being educated and in the voting process. We do not endorse a particular candidate. We just want our people, our community, to move forward and being a part of situations, experiences, movements that's going to make a difference for our generations to come. And we're going to move us out of our comfort zone and put us in positions where we do have voices at the table, so that whatever decisions are being made, we are considered as being part of those decisions that's sensitive to our needs and our community. Having said that, we have teamed up with Houston and San Antonio coalitions as well. I call them Team Texas as such, and we about to release, we'll be releasing a public service announcement. This is part of the sermon here as well. We'll seek to tie in this scripture here that we have from Mark, the 9th chapter, verses 49 through 50. It's taken from the New Living Translation from our Bible. Jesus said, "For everyone will be tested by fire. Salt is good for seasoning, but if it loses its flavor, how do you make it salty again? You must have the qualities of salt among yourselves and live in peace with each other." For a few more moments, we want to share words around this thought of flavored to last. Flavor it to last, and with accompanied by the public service announcement, the PSA that we'll be releasing. We're releasing it today. That will hope draw your attention and draw others' attention that we are still here.
we are still here. From rivers to streets, we are still here.
From pastures to playgrounds, we are still here.
From night skies and star maps to sunrise and morning traffic, we are still here.
From council meetings to boardrooms, we are still here.
From ceremony to state capitol, we are still here. From homelands to cities, we are still here.
From past to present to our future, we are still here.
From all walks of four directions, we are still here. From prairies to mountains, we are still here.
We are still here today and every day.
We are still here.
These two verses, verses 49 and 50, have many different interpretations that theologians have drawn from the meaning of these two verses. Certainly salt has many qualities, different qualities about it. For today's lesson in association with we being here, we want to look at the preservation that salt has in our lives. And we are called, all right, let's see if we can get this person here to mute, I guess. Okay, all right. We're gonna mute people. Okay, but sometimes we do it. We try to make it as an experience, just like we're in church. Yeah, we are in church, and sometimes folk here in the pews can add flavor to the church experience. Amen. That's part of being in church. Amen. Words around this thought, flavor to last, and drawing from what salt has been used for is to preserve meat from rotting or decaying. We ought to have qualities like that where we preserve the peace that should exist for all of God's children, that we act as the agents, whereas we can be a part of the solution. We'd be a part of preserving that which is sacred, part of preserving that which is good and proper and prosperous for our generations. Jesus said this in response to, if you read all of the ninth chapter, about things that would prevent us from having a right relationship with God. In fact, Jesus uses some strong language there about those who are not salted. Those who are not part of the purity that salt would bring as a compound, those who would destroy the peace are held bound. And those who have such a condition, if it is identified as a foot that causes you to sin, or an eye that causes you to sin, or some body part, then that should be eliminated from our lives. Mm-hmm. We should eliminate those things that do not keep us in a right relationship with God. We should be seasoned, if you will, as sacrifices unto the purposes of God. If you would like a further study of these two verses, I invite you to come Wednesday night, and we can delve a little bit into it in terms of how the Hebrews use salt, okay, as part of the grain offerings, the thank offerings. They use a pinch of salt as a witness of the purity of God, the lasting and the perseverance of one trying to have a relationship with God, the cleansing. It also represents that as well. The relationship, it has been a tradition that if you eat a person's salt, then they're your friend. For life. All of those went into the thanksgiving that the priests showed by sprinkling salt on the grain offerings, the flour offerings. It was made of flour and was added a little bit of, in my mind, a flavor to it. Christians, those who follow Jesus, ought to have some flavor in their lives. We have to have a witness about the God that we serve, the God that we say is ours, the Almighty God. And it must be a witness that helps preserve the peace, help preserve the well-being of others as well as ourselves. Salt has those probabilities. Properties of it to preserve and make sure that things does not go rotten on us. And we should have that about us, the salt as living sacrifices in us, to make sure that not only our lives are impacted positively, but our brothers and sisters around us, that we love our neighbors as ourselves. That we should have some salt about us, that we, like the PSA would suggest, are still here, that we have been preserved by God for a purpose. Before 1742, when this person called Columbus came here and so say discovered land, and actually he found folk had been here thousands of years before, our ancestors, and how it is estimated in North America alone there was over 300 million of our ancestors here. And now it's down to perhaps millions because of someone else not being salted as they should and wanted to get all that they could get, that had a linear view instead of a circular view. That we are going through all of that cultural, physical genocide, the remnant that is left are still here. And I would suggest that God has flavored us to last for a reason, to be the people that God are calling us to be. Though small in number we may be, but I just have a belief, and God has showed me over and over again that God takes a little and makes much out of it. Mm-hmm. That one person can put to flight 10,000 people. Mm-hmm. That it does not take an army of folk. It just takes that one person who is salted. Salted to last and to stand in the face of prejudice and discrimination, of misuse and abuse, to still stand because we're salted. We're salted with a spirit that is way beyond our human spirit. It is the spirit of the living God now indwelling those who are salted by God's fire, to stand if we have to stand alone. To make a difference in whomever's life that we touch that day, that we are flavored to last. Sometimes we get weary. We understand that. Sometimes the way is hard. Yes, it is. And it should be hard. If it was easy, anybody could do it. But it takes a child of God to be lasting. It takes the salt that God has seasoned us with to stand in the face of death. To even go through death and then come out and say, thank God. It takes something of being salted in the word of God that will exercise itself, that in death even we will trust in God. That we are salted, we are flavored to last in eternity. That Jesus had came here as God sent him, as God's son, as God's self, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Our life as followers of Christ does not begin when we pass from this physical state that we're in, but it begins now. We have an eternal self that is built to last based on the fire of God now living in us, so that we could be salt of the earth, light for the earth, a witness to let others know that there is hope. There is a God that we can depend upon no matter what the circumstances are. If we need to adjust ourselves, we will do that because we're built to last. If we need to go to war, we'll do that because we're built to last. If we need to be in the valleys as well as the mountaintops, we are built to last. We are flavored with the salt of God that no matter what the circumstances, even if God was to slay us, we would be like Job. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him because I've been salted. To last, no matter what you go through. And certainly Job is the epitome of all the things that could go wrong in a person's life. But Job makes this declaration, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. And you cannot get that way unless you have been flavored, assaulted in your relationship with God. I'm working on that. If I thought God would be out to kill me right now, will I trust him in that? But when you're flavored with the salt of God, when you are flavored and you know that God has built me to last, that God has saved me for an eternity, that this temporary stuff is just that, temporary. Trouble don't last always, those songs said. No, it's not. I'm on my way to an eternal home because I'm flavored. I'm salted to last. I've been through the trials. I've been through the fire. I've been through that which has made me cry bitter tears at night. I'm still here. No matter where you think you ought to be, you are here. Because God has placed you here. And if you're still here, we have a purpose. If you're still here with us, then you are salted to last. And not fearing what others may do. Not fearing what will be done to us. Not dwelling on what has happened to us. we can complain all day. Hmm? And they're not going to give Florida back to us.
The position that we're in here, because we're here, and we have to have the attitude that God has salted me, God has flavored me to make a positive difference.
I go to Florida. I gotta go to Mississippi, and I can think about what has happened in the past. But I'm here now. What are you doing today? If you're flavored with God's salt. No matter what has happened to you, you will be a positive preservant in somebody's life of well-being. That you can stand when all others won't stand. When all others have deserted you, you'll still be able to stand. When you're old and you're getting on in age, you still have the strength that Caleb had. Because you're built to last, that you're flavored to last, that through these troubling times, which are temporary, I am towards an eternal home. When you have an eternal view instead of a temporary view, this temporary stuff that happened. Oh, my car broke down. Oh, I lost a job. Oh, the children not acting right. I made a mistake today. All this temporary stuff. I'm here to tell you that God's children are eternal children and we're built to last. Come what may, from day to day, I know that God has an eternal place for me. I'm an eternal being right now because I'm salted. I'm flavored to make a positive difference, that I can go to a sick person's home and lay my hands on a sick person and that person will be well because I have faith in the God who has salted me to be an instrument in God's hands, to be an agent of God's love, to be a witness of God's forgiveness, to speak peace where there is confusion, to open up doors that are closed in our faces, because we are eternal beings. In the blood of Christ. We are flavored to last. And should we remember that we are called to a higher calling of flavoring the situations in our lives? Sometimes we can add some extra ingredients into the circumstances of our lives that just ruin the whole recipe. But if you just have a pinch, pinch of salt, a pinch of flavor, you add a little bit of Choctaw in it. You add a little bit of Creek in it. What you're flavored with, the traditions that you've come to know, the experiences that God has given us, do you add to that recipe? I like some pork chops. I like to know that when I'm in a situation that I'm adding some pork chops to that situation. I need to know that I'm adding something that's going to make a positive difference in a person's lives. What do you bring to the table? What do you bring as an ingredient to the recipe of life? Are you salt or are you sour water? Do you bring joy or do you complain? Do you bring peace? Or it's always yada, 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 yada. We have been flavored to last. Only God's word is eternal. We have to have God's word in our lives, living by it, breathing by it, eating by it. Whatever we do, we do it in the name of Christ Jesus, as Colossians 3:17. That whatever we do,
We do it with the eye of eternity. That we are eternal beings, that we are favored to last. Amen and amen. We want to now sing an old familiar hymn. Jesus loves me. We talk about Jesus loved the little kids, and we are to love Jesus with that same type of innocency, that same type of purity, that same type of view. We want to love God as God has loved us, if at all possible. Let us stand and sing, "Oh, How I Love Jesus," by Ray Allen. Yeah, not Ray Allen. What's this? Allen Johnson.
There is the doors of the church open. I love to hear, I love to sing. It's word that sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how yes. I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me, it tells me of a Savior's love, died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect clean. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Amen. Amen. Because of God's everlasting love. Every love.
It tells of one whose loving heart can fill my deepest woes. Oh, who in its sorrow bears a heart none can bear before. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
You make me see. You make me see. Amen.